Bernini's sculpture of the Ecstasy of Saint Teresa in the Church of Our Lady of Victory is one of the best examples of how divergent the lens of a tourist can be from that of a pilgrim. This sculpture group was begun by John Lorenzo Bernini in 1644, a period of grave difficulty for the 46-year-old superstar artist. After 20 years of being the darling of papal court, he had run afoul of Pope Innocent X and was about to be fired from his high-profile commissions. But out of that dark moment came light. Hi, I'm Liz Lev, and I'm an art historian, and you're listening to the podcast From Tourists to Pilgrims. The Cornaro family offered him an exciting contract for a church that had been recently completed by Bernini's old patron Scipione Borghese. Bernini was going to produce a statue of a recently canonized Saint Teresa of Avila, offering the artist the opportunity to create the iconography of a new saint. This challenge spurred Bernini to new creative heights. Rather than focusing on her tireless work and her role in founding the Discalced Carmelites, or on her profoundly influential writings, Bernini was drawn to her inner life, her spiritual experiences called ecstasies. These events were described by the Spanish nun in her copious writing, the most common being the vision of a slight angel, perhaps a seraphim, holding a long flaming dart with a little fire which he passed through her heart into her body, but after the pain it left her wholly inflamed with the love of God. Bernini was driven to help pilgrims to share in this divine vision, and to do so, he took art to a whole new level. Combining painting and sculpture and architecture, Bernini constructed a sort of theater, the first artist to think like a movie director. Members of the Cornaro family occupied the side boxes, but the best seats in the house were reserved for the pilgrim, happening off the long Via Pia, now differently named, from a city gate a half mile away. Inside this Fabergé egg of a church, glistening with polished marbles and stucco angels gamboling above, Bernini's statue group did and does elicit a gasp of amazement from both tourists and pilgrims alike, as it is unlike anything ever produced in art before it. Ecstatic saints had grown popular in the Renaissance, gazing towards the heavens with a rapt expression. But Bernini suspended the pair in mid-air. The angel in pure white marble holds the gilded arrow, and Teresa lies recumbent, her eyes semi-closed and her bare foot dangling off the cloud. A heavy cornice hangs above, neatly separating the colorful marble space below from the gold and white confection above, intended to symbolize the heavens. A luminous fresco spreads across the vault, depicting the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove, the originator of this spiritual event. Below, Bernini took inspiration from Caravaggio's unseen light sources as he placed a hidden window above his sculpture group to allow natural light to flood the scene below. More than just improved illumination, this is the Holy Spirit descending into the world. The beauty of the work drew the grand tourists of the 18th century, startled to see such sensuality and excitement in a religious work. With their worldly eyes, they looked upon the sculptures and snickered, interpreting the image as a depiction of earthly passion. In the age of enlightenment and reason, everything became grounded in human experience. Thus, Teresa's fiery love of the Lord became for tourists an image of amorous conquest. This view so permeated society that to this day, tourists pay for guided visits to hear about the fictitious scandal of the quote-unquote racy statue. But Bernini's pilgrims would be shocked, not by the work, but by the modern reaction. His contemporaries immediately understood what Bernini had done. As Galileo had brought the telescope to Rome to allow the human eye to see hidden celestial bodies, so Bernini had become a kind of telescope to the supernatural, allowing us to see what this remarkable saint had witnessed. Pilgrims looked at the suspended group and thought of ecstasy as ecstasis, being out of oneself, the rapt experiences shared by Philip Neri, John of the Cross, and many others who had given their lives entirely to Christ. They perhaps would have recognized under the voluminous draperies of Teresa the contours of the raised shoulder, the head thrown back, and the dangling arm. The same of Michelangelo's famous Christ of the Pietà. Teresa, who had given her entire self to Christ, was rewarded with the certainty of his existence and a taste of what his intense love for humanity would feel like in heaven. All her sacrifices and suffering were vindicated as she saw truth, something the wealthy, educated, devout members of the Cornaro family would have loved to experience as well. The turbulent drapery belies the limp body. Though Teresa, to her contemporaries, may have looked unconscious, her interior life was rocked like the crashing waves of an ocean. Bernini used those crevasses to give us a glimpse of the interior intensity of the saint who would become a doctor of the church in 1970. The bare foot, dangling below, was a reminder of her earthly task, the creation of the discalced or barefoot Carmelites. While this work may offer tourists a momentary giggle, it was made to comfort the weary pilgrim, tired from the physical journey, and perhaps assailed by doubt during the difficult era post the Protestant Reformation. The Ecstasy of Saint Teresa heralded the devotion to Christ's Sacred Heart, which would soon spread through Europe, revealing a God who felt passionate love for humanity. In this work, Bernini became not only the first iconographer of one of the greatest saints of the Catholic Church, but the image maker of a new era of revelation.
You've been listening to From Tourist to Pilgrim, a podcast written and narrated by Liz Lev, produced by Johanna Bronkova and Mara Micheli.